Today we are going to start with the topic reproduction in lower and higher animals. First of all, we will see what is reproduction. This reproduction is defined as a biological process of formation of new life forms from pre-existing similar life. What does it mean? See, formation of new life forms means the progeny which are formed. What is the meaning of pre-existing form? This pre-existing life form means the parents. So we can say that in the process of reproduction, parents give birth to the young ones. So new life forms are formed from the pre-existing life form. This is the process of reproduction. What is the importance of reproduction? This process of reproduction is important to maintain the continuity of the species. As the new life forms, which are exactly similar to their parents, are formed, there will be continuity in the species. Secondly, it is a vital process, and this vital process enables the species to survive over a long period. Even though the individual or organisms live naturally for a limited period of time, that is their life span. So, two importance: one is continuity of life, and secondly, it is a vital process which enables the species to survive over a long period of time. What is the content of this topic? Under this topic, we have to study about asexual reproduction in animals, and secondly, we have to study sexual reproduction in animals. Under sexual reproduction, we have to study human reproduction under the headings gametogenesis, fertilization, early embryology, parturition and reproductive health. We will start with its first part, that is asexual reproduction in animals. Asexual reproduction in case of animals, what are the characteristic features? First point, it is a common method among lower organisms. Secondly, there will be no gamete formation. As there is no gamete formation, there is no meiotic division, or there is no reductional division, as well as there will be no fusion of gametes. Thirdly, you should remember that as there is no fusion of gametes, no formation of gametes, there will be only single parent involved. No need of male and female individuals, and because of that, it is a uniparental type of reproduction. And the fourth important point is there. The progeny or the daughter cells or the offsprings which are formed are genetically identical to single parents. And this progeny or daughter cells are called as clones, which are exactly similar to their parents. So you have to remember this characteristic feature for asexual reproduction in case of animals can be asked for 2 marks. Now we are going to study about asexual reproduction in animals. It takes place by gemmule formation, and secondly, it takes place by budding. We'll see first one, that is process of gemmule formation. What is this gemmule? Remember that it is a internal bud which is formed inside the body. Secondly, it is found only in sponges. What are these sponges? These sponges belongs to phylum Porifera. That means pore-bearing animals, where there is no tissue, organ or system formation is there. In case of sponges or in case of porifers, just cells are get aggregated and results in formation of, we can say, the sponge-like structure. So this is for gemmule. What it consists of? This gemmule consists of archaeocytes. What do you mean by archaeocyte? It is the mass of dormant cell. Dormant means inactive cells. So this gemmule, it consists of dormant cells, a group of dormant cells, and these dormant cells are capable of producing new organisms. We can also say that archaeocytes are totipotent cells. That is, they are able to give new organisms. These archaeocytes, their mass is covered with a thick layer of secretion of amebocytes. Second type of cells, amoebocytes, are there, and they secrete a material which forms thick layer around the archaeocytes. When these gemmules are produced, when the conditions are unfavorable, so in order to get overcome these unfavorable conditions, these gemmules are formed, and one of the example mentioned in the book is Spongilla, belongs to phylum Porifera. We'll see the structure of gemmule. See, as we have studied, this gemmule, it consists of this inner mass of cells. These cells are called as archaeocytes, and these archaeocytes are covered by this thick layer of secretion which is secreted by the amoebocyte cells. This outer layer, in between here some spicules are seen. These spicules are for protection. So it consists of these inner cells of archaeocytes, and outer membrane is of thick material which is the secretion of amoebocyte. It also shows presence of your micropyle, and some spicules are there. This micropyle is for floating these gemmules in the water bodies, and spicules are for protection. Okay, so this is the structure of gemmule. Only diagram can be asked for 2 marks, with description can be asked for 3 marks. Now we are going to see about the process of budding. Here the example of budding is hydra, corals, and some ascidians. So hydra and corals, they belongs to phylum Cnidaria, or it belongs to phylum Cylindrata. While these ascidians, they belongs to phylum Chordata, subphylum Urochordata, and class Ascidia. Okay, so can be seen in case of invertebrates, and can be seen in case of vertebrates. Urochordates. What is the meaning of Urochordata? Animals in which the notochord is restricted to tail region. So in case of Ascidian also, this type of budding is seen. Okay, the diagram which is shown here, it is for budding in Hydra. So we'll see the diagrammatic presentation here. See, this is the first stage of the Hydra. This is the body of Hydra which starts showing this bud-like structure. Outgrowth is seen. In the second diagram, you can see that this bud is somewhat is growing. In the next diagram, you can see that your fully matured bud is get formed, where the tentacles are also seen. This is the body of Hydra, but still it is attached to the body of parent Hydra. And in the last diagram, you can see that this fully matured bud is get detached from the body of Hydra, and thus this new bud is get formed, which can grow into the adult Hydra or into the fully formed Hydra. So this is the process of budding in case of Hydra. See, only diagrammatic presentation can be asked for 2 marks, or their examples can be asked for 1 mark. So process of budding and process of gemmule formation, these are the process of asexual reproduction in case of lower animals. May possible that question of 3 marks will be asked directly as write a note on asexual reproduction in lower animals, or may possible that gemmule formation and budding can be asked separately for 2 marks. Now we are going to see sexual reproduction in case of animals. As previously explained, this sexual reproduction involves formation and fusion of gametes, which do not take place in case of asexual reproduction. So characteristic feature of sexual reproduction is formation and fusion of gametes. This fusion of gamete is also called as amphimixis, amphi for both, that is male and female gametes are fused together. Process is called as amphimixis. Remember that in case of sexual reproduction, the progeny which is formed, it's somewhat different to that of their parents. Why? Because of that, why the difference is seen? Difference is because of meiotic process, or because of reductional division, which takes place during gamete formation. Then sexually reproducing organism shows two phases in their life cycle. Which are these phases? First one is called as juvenile phase and second one is called as reproductive maturity phase. What are these? In case of juvenile phase, physical growth starts, which starts from the birth actually. So in juvenile phase, there will be growth phase, there will be physical growth of the body takes place, and in this phase that animal cannot reproduce. So there will be growth of the body, physical growth of the body with physical growth of the reproductive organs takes place. Second step is called as a reproductive maturity phase. In this phase, animal can reproduce sexually because here these reproductive organs are get matured because of their growth, and as they are matured, they will take part in the process of reproduction. This period, juvenile phase and reproductive phase, their periods are variable in different animals. That means years for juvenile phase may be somewhat different in case of animals. Reproductive maturity phase may be different in case of different animals. So this juvenile phase means what? It is the phase of somatic growth. And reproductive maturity phase means what? Where the reproductive organs get matured and can take part in the process of reproduction. So after attaining the sexual maturity, once the organism attains sexual maturity, various events takes place in the process of reproduction, like gametogenesis means the formation of gametes. Once the gametes are formed, gamete transfer takes place. This gamete transfer later on results in the process of fertilization, that is fusion of male and female gametes, which results in the formation of zygote. And once zygote is get formed, there will be post-fertilization events takes place, and at last there will be parturition, that is the birth of that young one takes place. Okay, so these are the events. Now we are going to see about breeding patterns. There are two types of breeding patterns. First one is called as seasonal breeder and second one is called as continuous breeder. These seasonal breeders, they breed for a limited period of time. That means for some of the, just for 1 or 2 months of the year, in that period only this seasonal breeder can breed. Why? Because that period is safe for their young ones. Conditions are favorable for the food and water and for getting the mate. Examples are goat, sheep and donkey. Second one is called as continuous breeder. Continuous breeder, examples are here ape and man, that is they can breed throughout the year. So ape are the closest relative of human. We can say that human beings, they evolve from the ape. So just simply seasonal breeder, their examples, and continuous breeder, their examples can be asked for 1 mark question. Now we are going to start with human reproduction. Main part of this topic. This human reproduction involves gametogenesis, process of gamete formation. Insemination means transfer of gamete into the female body. Internal fertilization, that is fusion of gametes inside the female body, which results in formation of zygote. Zygote results in formation of embryo called as embryogenesis. What is the meaning of gestation? Gestation is the period which is required for the development of complete embryo, and once the embryo is completely developed, gestation period when it is get over, the parturition, that means the childbirth, takes place. So these are the steps which come under human reproduction. Now we are going to see one by one. We are going to see about male reproductive system. What is this male reproductive system? What are the parts? This male reproductive system involves here first one, primary sex organ, which is called as testes. Why it's called as primary sex organ? Because it is concerned with production of sperm, the male gametes. So first part, primary sex organ, testes. Second one, it involves accessory ducts and accessory glands, which forms external and internal genitalia. What's the meaning of genitalia? Genitalia means the reproductive organs. We are going to see about accessory ducts, which are found inside the body, hence internal accessory ducts. These are rete testes, vasa efferentia, epididymis, vas deferens, ejaculatory duct and urethra. Then which are the accessory glands? These accessory glands found internally are seminal vesicles, prostate glands and Cowper's glands, which are also called as bulbourethral gland. What are external genitalia, which are formed on the surface of the body, are the penis and scrotum. So these are the organs which are included under male reproductive system. We are going to see in detail about this male reproductive organs. Now see here, this is a diagram for male reproductive system. We have seen that this testes, these two are the testes, which are primary sex organs. Then we have to see about accessory ducts. These accessory ducts includes this epididymis. Rete testes is found internally, that means we can see in the longitudinal section only. So this epididymis is seen. Epididymis, it continues into this vas deferentia. This is the vas deferentia. This vas deferentia, it continues here and it continues into this urethra. So epididymis, vasa deferentia, this is the part of vasa deferentia itself. And here there will be presence of ejaculatory duct, not visible in the diagram. I will tell you later on in the separate diagram what is the ejaculatory duct. And this urethra, these are found internally, hence it is the internal reproductive accessory ducts. Then we'll see accessory glands. In the diagram you can see this leaf like structure is seen here on the both the sides. This is called as seminal vesicles. This is about the prostate gland on both the sides, and this small pea sized glands are there, which are called as bulbourethral glands, also called as Cowper's glands. So this is accessory glands concerned with the process of reproduction. Which are the external genitalia? External genitalia includes scrotum. Scrotum means this pouch like structure which is present around the testes. So scrotum and the penis, this structure penis, which is found on the surface of the body, becomes external genitalia. So what we have seen in this diagram, primary sex organ called as testes. Secondly, we have seen accessory ducts like epididymis, this vasa deferentia, then here the ejaculatory ducts are there, and then this urethra. Then we have seen accessory glands, seminal vesicles, this Cowper's gland, and this bulbourethral glands, also called as Cowper's glands, are accessory glands. And thirdly, we have seen external genitalia, which includes this pouch-like structure. This blue-colored pouch-like structure is seen, that is scrotum, and this penis becomes the external genitalia. Now we have to see in detail. We have to see in detail about the structure of testes, and for that we have to see its vertical section, that is longitudinal section LS, and we have to see transverse section, that is TS of testes. We'll see another diagram for that. Now see, this diagram is for longitudinal section of testes. We will see that this testes are covered by three coverings. Which are the three coverings of testes? In the diagram it is clear that testes consist of outermost covering called as tunica vaginalis. This is the tunica vaginalis. Middle covering is called as tunica albuginea. Middle layer is tunica albuginea and innermost layer is called as tunica vasculosa. So, testes covered by pre-covering, outermost tunica vaginalis, middle is tunica albuginea and innermost is called as tunica vasculosa. Vasculosa is for what? For consisting of a rich supply of blood vessels which provide nourishment to the testes, nourishment to the structure present inside the testes. So remember, three coverings are there which surrounds the testes externally. Later on, we have to see this internal structure. You can see that this testes is divided into many compartments. 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. There are many compartments are there and each compartment consists of about 1 to 4 seminiferous tubules. So if you are going to consider, this is one of the compartment, this is second compartment. So in this compartment, you can see here these coiled structures are present. This coiled structure present inside the testes in the compartment, in each compartment number is 1 to 4, are called as seminiferous tubules. See here, seminiferous tubules are the structural and functional unit of testes. So these seminiferous tubules on its surface, they join together. Here this joining is visible. They join together and form this network-like structure. This network-like structure on the surface of testes is called as rete testes. Then these tubules of the rete testes come together and results in formation of these fine tubules. These fine tubules are called as vasa efferentia. You can see here it is labeled as vasa efferentia. So this vasa efferentia join together and after their joining, the results in formation of this fine duct. This fine duct, which is in coiled manner, it is get fitted into a structure which is called as epididymis. So epididymis is a duct which is present over the surface of this testes here. This epididymis, as the diagram shows, it is a long coiled tube and is differentiated into three parts. Upper one is called as caput epididymis, which is called as head of the epididymis. This middle region is called as corpus epididymis. Here this is the corpus epididymis middle region. And this lowermost part or the tail of this epididymis is called as cauda epididymis. So this is, it looks like a comma shaped structure, but it is not like that. In this comma shaped structure, here this duct of epididymis is kept in folded manner. It is in the coiled manner. So this much is the coiled part of the epididymis forming a duct-like structure having three parts, caput epididymis, corpus epididymis, and this part is called as cauda epididymis. Then this cauda epididymis, it continues as vas deferens, which continues, that means it runs upward into the abdominal cavity. It loop over the ureter and open into the urethra. Now how it is, we will see here once again the previous diagram. We have seen in this diagram, this is diagram testes, this is testes. We have seen longitudinal section in the diagram just before. So here this epididymis is formed over here. And this epididymis, it runs upward into the abdominal cavity through inguinal canal. It arches over the bladder. And later on, it opens into this urethra. We can see this testes also. From this testes, this rete testes is there. These are the efferent tubules, efferent ductules, which opens into the epididymis. Here this is the head of epididymis, that is caput. Middle part is called as corpus, and this is called as cauda epididymis. It runs upward through the inguinal canal into the abdominal cavity. It loops over the ureter, it loops over the bladder. Here, this is the bladder, loops over the bladder and it opens into the urethra. Okay, so this is for the ducts also. You can see here, this is the seminal vesicles on both the sides. Duct of seminal vesicle and duct of this vas deferentia, they join together and opens into this urethra. Here, this combined structure which is get formed, it is called as ejaculatory duct. Later on, we have to see about this urethra. Remember that this urethra is the common passage for urine as well as for semen. What is semen? Semen is the fluid which is secreted by seminal vesicles, which helps in lubrication of the system, as well as the sperms will get nourishment in the semen only. So semen, it passes through this urethra, as well as the urine will also pass through the urethra. Hence, in case of male individuals, this urethra is also called as urinogenital duct. So this is for the urethra. Now see, around the urethra you can see this structure which is called as penis, that is the part of external genitalia. Then what we have studied till now, we have seen about the parts of male reproductive system, which includes primary sex organ called as testes. Secondly, we have seen accessory duct, which are also seen in the diagram. We have seen these glands and external genitalia called as penis and scrotum. Now we have to see about the details of these glands. Which glands? Glands are seminal vesicles. You can see here in the diagram, these are the seminal vesicles. This is prostate gland and these two are the corpus gland. We have to see their details. We are going to see about first one, that is seminal vesicles. It is a paired structure. You can see in the diagram, one pair of seminal vesicles is seen. And this lie on posterior side of bladder. Here this is the bladder and on the posterior side these two seminal vesicles are seen. What is the function? Function of seminal vesicle is to secrete a fluid which is alkaline in nature, called as seminal fluid. What is the constituents? What are the constituents found in seminal vesicles? Constituents are fructose, fibrinogen and prostaglandins. What are their function? The fructose found in seminal vesicles provide energy for the movement of sperms. What is the function of fibrinogen? It coagulates the semen into a bolus, or into a, we can say, thick structure, which is required for quick propulsion in the vagina, for the quick movement in the vagina. So function of fibrinogen is to bring about coagulation of semen, and prostaglandins stimulate reverse peristalsis in vagina and uterus for faster movement of sperms towards the egg in the female body. So you have to remember that seminal vesicles, it forms about 60% of the semen, consisting of fructose, fibrinogen and prostaglandins. Fructose is for energy for the movement of sperm. Fibrinogen is for the process of coagulation, and prostaglandins are for the quick movement, or we can say reverse peristalsis of the semen in vagina and in uterus for faster movement of sperms towards the egg. This is all about seminal vesicle. See, it is a paired structure. Now we are going to see about prostate gland. See, this is a prostate gland. Remember that it is a single gland. Even though it looks paired, it is not a paired structure, it is a single structure. It is made up of 20 to 30 lobes and located below the bladder. This is the bladder here. This is the complete structure of bladder, and below the bladder here this prostate is appeared, a single structure. In the diagram it is very clear that this is urethra and this prostate, it surrounds the urethra. What is the function of this prostate gland? It secretes a fluid which is called as prostatic fluid, and is this prostatic fluid, it forms 30% of the semen. 60% is secreted by seminal vesicle, 30% is secreted by prostate gland. And what are the constituents, what are the components found in prostatic fluid? Citric acid, acid phosphatase and other enzymes. Function of acid phosphatase is to protect the sperms from acidic environment in the vagina. What is vagina? Vagina is the part of female reproductive system where the sperms are inseminated. So these sperms should remain alive in female reproductive tract in the vagina. Vagina have acidic environment because of presence of the acidic material. So in this acidic environment, sperm cannot be remain alive. So in order to protect them, acid phosphatase is secreted by prostate gland. Third gland is called as Cowper's gland, which is also called as bulbourethral gland. This is, you can see the diagram, it is a paired structure and small pea-like structure, pea-sized. What's the function of this gland? It also secretes alkaline viscous fluid, which is mucus-like, streaky-like mucus, and it acts as lubricant during the copulation. Okay, so you have to remember the secretions and their functions as well as their nature, whether it is acidic or alkaline. Okay, so here these three glands, seminal vesicle, prostate gland and this bulbourethral gland, secrete the semen. All are alkaline in nature for protecting the sperms in acidic environment of the vagina. Okay, so this is for the system having primary sex organ testes. Then we have seen the accessory ducts and accessory glands along with their functions. We have seen this longitudinal section diagram also. Now we are going to see about the transverse section of testes. In this transverse section, we have studied before also this TS of testes. What it shows in hormonal coordination, we have seen the structure of testes, that it shows presence of this tubule. This circular structure is called as seminiferous tubule. Here these half circle structures are also seminiferous tubule. So remember, seminiferous tubules are structural and functional unit of the testes. We'll see the structure of one seminiferous tubule. You can see this is the basement membrane. On this basement membrane, this is also a basement membrane, you can see these cells. These are the cells of germinal epithelium. These cells of germinal epithelium undergoes the process of spermatogenesis. And because of process of spermatogenesis, that is the process of formation of sperm, these primary spermatocytes are formed from spermatogonium. So these cells of germinal epithelium are called as spermatogonium. This spermatogonium results in formation of primary spermatocytes. They lead to the formation of secondary spermatocytes. Secondary spermatocytes leads into the formation of spermatids, and this spermatids at last results in formation of sperms. This will come under the process of spermatogenesis. So what to remember? This seminiferous tubule consists of germinal epithelial cells, and this germinal epithelial cells undergoes the process of gametogenesis and results in formation of sperms. Now you can see that in between the germinal epithelial cells, here this pyramid like cells are appeared. This is a long cell. These pyramid like cells are called as Sertoli cells. These Sertoli cells are also called as Nerve cells. What is the function of these Sertoli cells or the nerve cells? These Sertoli cells or the nerve cells, they provide nourishment to these immature sperms. By their head, they get attached to the Sertoli cells and derive nourishment. So this is about the structure of single seminiferrostribule, which is the structural and functional unit of the testes. Then we'll see that in between seminiferrostribules, here this connective tissue is found. And in this connective tissue, we can see the cells, which are called as Leydig cells. Leydig cells are also called as interstitial cells. And we have studied before, these Leydig cells or interstitial cells are stimulated by one of the hormones from anterior pituitary, which is called as LH, also called as ICSH. Why ICSH? Because this hormone ICSH, interstitial cell stimulating hormone, stimulate these Leydig cells or the interstitial cells, which results in release of testosterone, and testosterone is required for the development of secondary sexual characters. Okay, so in TS, what to explain? You have to explain about this seminiferrostribule having germinal epithelial cells, which undergoes the process of spermatogenesis through the stages like primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocytes, spermatids, and Sertoli cells. And second thing you have to remember about this Leydig cells or interstitial cells, which are responsible for secretion of testosterone. And remember that Leydig cells or interstitial cells are stimulated by ICSH, that is interstitial cells stimulating hormone of anterior pituitary. Okay, so this is for transverse section of testes. So under this human reproduction, what we have studied today, we have studied about human reproduction. Under that, male reproductive system having primary sex organ, testes, then it includes accessory ducts, accessory glands, and external genitalia. Then we have seen about the diagram of this reproductive system. We have studied about longitudinal section of testes, and we have studied about transverse section of testes. So diagrams are important, system is important. Big questions of 4 marks can also be asked from this part. Remaining part we are going to continue in the next lecture.